Sleigh bells ring, are you listening? In the lane, snow is glistening. A beautiful sight, we're happy tonight. Walking in a winter wonderland.
Ho, ho, ho. It's Santa here. A very Merry Christmas and the happiest New Year. Ho, ho, ho.
Here comes Santa Claus, here comes Santa Claus, right down Santa Claus Lane. Dixon and Dixon and all his reindeers pulling on the reins. Bells are ringing, children singing, all is merry and bright. So hang your stockings and say your prayers, cause Santa Claus comes tonight.
You're as charming as an eel, Mr. Grinch. You're a bad banana with a greasy black peel.
It's the most wonderful time of the year. There'll be much mistletoeing, hearts will be glowing when loved ones are near. It's the most wonderful time. Yes, the most wonderful time. Oh, the most wonderful time of the
Prepare me Merry Christmas. Come on, man. We're going to sing a song right now. We actually, our team, we wrote this and recorded it last year. I hope you remember. I hope you enjoy it. It's called Emmanuel. Here we go.
Behold, a son shall come to earth.
Yeah.
Born of a virgin, the seed.
To just pray with you. There's something heavy on your heart, something that you're facing right now, and you don't know the answer. You're feeling overwhelmed, stressed out. our prayer team, they're going to be here to pray with you as we sing this last song. Father God, we just bless you. We bless you. Yes, we do, God. beautiful. Can we sing this? Come on, lift it up.
Jesus in the street.
Situations to shift and change. There are some of you, and during this song, you felt something. You weren't feeling it before, but you felt something, and you wondered, wow, well, they must really sound good today. This must be an encouraging atmosphere. The reality is you felt faith and the presence of God. That's the truth. And I believe that there's something that wants to be released. There's something on the inside of you that's calling out, and you might not even be aware of it. And I want us to sing that song one more time, especially the bridge, to shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus from the streets. In other words, Jesus from everywhere. Let Jesus inundate every part of who we are so that all that manifests is Jesus. When that happens, things shift, things change. Would you lift your hands with me all over the building?
Yes.
And let's sing that together. Shout Jesus from the mountains and Jesus from the streets.
Shout Jesus, shout Jesus.
Shout Jesus from the mountains.
Come on.
Jesus in the
streets. Lift your voice, whether you're in the building or online.
Jesus in the darkness.
Let this place be filled with the praises of God.
Jesus for my family. I speak the whole.
Every enemy.
Every enemy.
change, break every stronghold.
Break every stronghold.
Shine through the shadows. Illuminate, God.
Burn
in the name of Jesus. Father, we honor you today. We thank you for being our healer. We thank you for being our transformer, our deliverer, our healer, our friend, our advocate. We could go on and on describing who you are. We thank you for that today. Lord, I lift up everyone within the sound of my voice, whether they're online or in the building, and I pray, Father, that they would experience you. We've ever had before. Now, the only thing that really upsets me about that is when we lose power, we lose our online audience. But now, hopefully, in Jesus' name, we've gotten them back. But I believe, yeah, put your hands together. Let's give God some praise. Hallelujah. God's good. Would you do me a favor and put your hands together for the team? Our dance team, our music team. They've been working diligently. We have had, you name it, the amount of technical issues we've had today. But I'm just very, very thankful. Father, I was talking to you until everything went away. And I honor you today, and I thank you for every person. God, I thank you for those that I'm hoping and believing can hear me online. And Lord, we're just declaring a great day in you. We love you. We thank you for our friends and our guests that are with us today. God, we pray that today would be impactful in the mighty, powerful, and matchless name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. You can be seated in his presence. Pastor Jaquan, if you could help me out with that. Is there anybody excited about Christmas? Hallelujah. Every kid probably just lost their minds. And I think it probably already came on there, but all of our kids can be released to go into Harvest Kids so they can have their worship experience. Let's thank God for our kids today. Well, y'all are in for it today. I've not preached in 2 weeks. I'm playing. I'm just playing. I do have a word that I believe that God has given to me for today. It's been something that's been marinating in me for some time. For those of you that are guests with us, I'm hoping that maybe you got one of these from someone that you're close to, a friend, a coworker, a family member, and I just want to tell you how deeply honored we are that you're here today. Honestly, yeah, put your hands together. We thank God for them. Truthfully, we've been praying for you. We've been praying that God would send you here, that you would be in this place today, and that you would encounter him. Encountering God is a real cool thing. It revolutionizes your life. It changes your world. It does some intense stuff. I got a lot of streams I'm feeling right now in my spirit, and I want to make sure that I flow in the right one. For those of you that are guests, say, what do you mean you feel streams? In other words, directions. Areas that I feel like God might be pulling me into, and I want to properly discern what directions are now and what directions are for the future. But I just can't deny that I feel him in this place. I've got a very good friend. I got two very good friends with me today, Bob and Peggy Budsey, people that are dear to me. I love you guys. It is so good to see you today. Just really, really excited. Grab your Bibles. Let's just get into this thing. Romans 8, 14 through 16. Romans 8, 14 through 16. And we like to honor the reading of the word, so we stand when we read the Bible. We just believe that renders respect as we read his word. How many of you realize it's not just some book, it's the book? Yeah. Hallelujah. Romans 8, 14 through 16. Romans 8, 14 through 16. I'm going to read it from the Passion Translation. That's what's on the screens, so you can follow along with me there. The mature children of God are those who are moved by the impulses of the Holy Spirit. Well, that is a powerful sentence. The mature children of God are those who are moved by the impulses of the Holy Spirit. And you did not receive the spirit of religious duty, leading you back into fear of never being good enough. But you have received the spirit of full acceptance, enfolding you into the family of God. Don't you love this verbiage? And you will never feel orphaned. For as he rises within us, our spirits join him in saying the words of tender affection, beloved Father. In other translations specific to the original text, it says, Abba, Father. For the Holy Spirit makes God's fatherhood real to us as he whispers into our innermost being, you are God's beloved child. Father, I know that I've already prayed, but I ask a special empowerment. I ask a special grace to be on this message today. May I articulate these words the way that you gave them to me. And Lord, I pray that they would not hear me, but that they would hear you as we experience the fullness of who you are in the preaching of the word today. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. And everyone said, amen. You can be seated. Direct your attention to the screens for our first clip.
Buddy, I think there's something I probably should tell you. You should, probably should have found out a long time ago. I then proceeded to tell Buddy of how his father had fallen in love when he was very young with a beautiful girl named Susan Wells, and how Buddy was born and put up for adoption by his mother, and how she had later passed away. I told him his father had never even known that Buddy was born. And most importantly, I told him where his father was, in a magical land called New York City. And I'll always be here for you. Now, go. Get.
I love that movie. Don't judge me. That's one of my favorite Christmas movies. I own it. I'm a big SNL fan. And all right. So I've got some other SNL fans in the building. For those of you that don't know what I'm talking about, Google it. No, it's Saturday Night Live. I love Saturday Night Live. It's a little interesting, but I'm interesting. The clip opens us up with what's going on in Buddy the Elf's life. And everything that Buddy had known up until this point of the movie, he believed to be reality. He believed himself to be an elf. He believed himself to be part of everything that happens in that fairy tale environment. And then he discovers he's not who he thought he was. And he starts dealing with this thing. You know, it really takes me to the reality of the power of perception. Everybody say perception. When I think about the power of perception, it really opens things up, because your perception will dictate to you your reality, even though it might not be reality. It was not real that Buddy was an elf, but Buddy thought he was an elf. It wasn't until he went through a series of hurting situations and circumstances and then overheard a conversation that he's like, oh my goodness, and his world is rocked. His perception was wrong. A.W. Tozer is a biblical theologian and scholar. I love his pieces and his work on discipleship. He's just an incredible man. He's obviously since passed away now. It's some old writings, but he says this: what comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us. In other words, our perception of God is the most important thing. There's lots of people that have lots of different perceptions of God. You have that bulk of society that see God as this cosmic light, this eternal being, this nameless, faceless entity that exists from a lot of people's perspective, from a very impersonal space or place. Their concept of God is that he's maybe there. They really don't know. It's just one of those could be. And then there are other people, and they have this grandfather image of God. You know, the long white beard, a little bit slower, maybe feeble. You know, maybe he's not able to do all that he used to do because he's now a little bit more aged and mature. You know, maybe his font on his phone is so big you can read it across the room. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You know, just he's always got some candy in his pocket though, right? Right. This is a lot of people's perception of God, but he's so distant that he's not consulted for the relevancy of where you are right now in your life. So he's just a really nice, sweet old guy. For others, maybe God is that divine scorekeeper who's in heaven keeping track of all that we've done, of all that we're doing, and looking for an opportunity maybe to be Zeus-like and zap us with a lightning bolt. Watching out, you know, kind of like Santa Claus. He knows who's naughty. He knows who's nice. But really believing that God is the type of Santa Claus that really wants to put coal in the stockings. And then there's the side of society that sees God as this butler that you can just ask for things when you want it, when you need it, and then he's not there when you're not needing something. Almost like a digital Siri or Alexa. Hey, Alexa, play order from Amazon, Alexa. You know, maybe that's what our prayer life is like. God, I need you to do this right now. We have all of these, and honestly, guys, I could go on and on with this about perceptions of who God is and what God is on a regular basis. We could just keep going and going and going on this all day, but Tozer's statement finishes by saying this: we tend by secret law of the soul to move toward our mental image of God. In other words, whatever our perception is will determine our pursuit. If we have a skewed or flawed perspective, we will have a flawed life. Why? If my perception of God is flawed, why would my life be flawed? Because you were hardwired by God to have something on the inside of you that pushes you to him, that draws you to him. If that is flawed, your life will be flawed. So we've got to get this right. Buddy's interruption in his fairy tale living causes perplexity on the inside of him. Causes him to start scratching his head. Honestly, with where he's at in his experiences, it causes him to doubt everything, which causes him to question his identity. Direct your attention to the screens. Let's watch one more clip.
Hey, buddy, want to pick some strawberries?
Not now, Arctic Puffin.
Hello, buddy.
Oh, hi, Leon.
Why the long face, partner?
It seems I'm
not an elf.
Of course you're not. You're 6'3" and had a beard since you were 15.
Papa says my real father lives in a magical place far away. I don't know what to do.
At least you have a daddy. I was just rolled up one day and left out here in the cold.
But the thing is, I've never even left the North Pole.
Buddy, I've been around the world many times when I was a young cumulus nimbus cloud. It's a wonderful place filled with wondrous creatures, except dogs. Oh, by the way, don't eat the yellow snow.
Oh, I know that.
All I'm saying is this might be the golden opportunity to find out who you really are.
Bye, guys.
Bye, buddy.
Bye, buddy. Take care.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, buddy.
Bye, buddy. Hope you find your dad.
Thanks, Mr. Narwhal. Bye.
When the question of fatherhood is not answered, identity is the very next thing that starts to be attacked. Let's look over right now at 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter, the 17th verse. It says this: therefore, if anyone is in Christ, everybody say in Christ, the new creation has come, the old has gone, the new is here. But identity is a rough thing, because most of us establish our identity out of what we do. I'm a frequent flyer. I fly quite often, and here lately, because of Jada's involvement with school, and she's not homeschooled anymore, and my wife needed to be with her and so forth, I'm flying by myself more than I used to fly by myself. And the top three questions when you sit down in the airplane and you start taking off, because frequent flyers are communicators, because it's just what they do, right? And so you sit down in your seat, and the very first question is, what's your name, right? Where are you going, and what do you do, right? And for me and my occupation, I have fun with that one. You know, there's some times where I just come right out and say, yeah, I'm a pastor, I'm a minister. And then there's some times where I say, I work for a rich Jew. And that invokes great conversation. But they want to know what you do. And unfortunately, what we do is relative to our identity. I had a very good friend a number of years ago who was in the Navy. And his position was that of weather. He was in charge of determining what the weather was going to be, predicting how things were going to work weather-wise, so that he could meet with the generals and those that are about to take combat-based situations and operations and give them counsel on how they needed to conduct themselves, whether they needed to do the mission or not, what they needed to do, all based on the weather. So he had a very influential position in the Navy. Well, he finally retires from the Navy at a young age, and he gets out, and he sits down with me, and he says, I don't know who I am. I have been accustomed to being an officer in the Navy. I've been accustomed to being in rooms with generals and high-ranking officers, making decisions that were going to greatly influence a lot of lives. That was what I did on a regular basis. I'm a civilian now. I don't know what to do. And so we started having regular conversations and regular talks on identity, because we've got to know who we are before we ever have a bearing on what we do. We have to know who we are. And what gives us that identity should be a relationship with the Father. But unfortunately, too often what gives us our identity is what we do, where we come from, who our father, who our mother is, what our political affiliation is, what our church affiliation is, what area we grew up in, our educational bracket. All of those things make those deciding factors on who we think we are, and we still struggle with this identity complex. I know individuals that when they retire, They go through a massive identity crisis because they were so accustomed to what they do, they missed who they were. But that needs to be signed, settled, and dealt with on a spiritual level. But this is the reality, guys. Life happens. Life happens, and life is very real. Life is very raw, and life does not care who you think you are. Can anybody relate to that? I got one more clip, and then I'm going to tie this thing up. Let's watch one more clip so that we can see where we're going today.
Dad!
All right, let's get it over with.
I walked all day and night to find you.
You look like you came from the North Pole.
That's exactly where I came from. Santa must have called you.
Oh, yeah, sure. He just got off the cell phone with me.
He did?
So, go on.
Go on with what?
Well, are you going to sing a song or something, or can I just go back to work?
A song? Yeah. Anything for you, Dad. I'm here with my dad, and we never met, and he wants me to sing him a song. And I was adopted, but you didn't know I was born. So I'm here now. I found you, Daddy. And guess what? I love you. I love you. I love you.
Wow. That was weird. Usually you guys just, put my name in the jingle bells or something.
It's me, your son. Susan Wells had me, and she didn't tell you. But now I'm here. It's me, Buddy.
Susan Wells. You said Susan Wells?
Yes.
Who sent this Christmas gram?
What's a Christmas gram? I want one.
I think we should call security.
Good idea. I like to whisper, too.
It's interesting how perception is compounded. Buddy's life was drastically changed with information. And now Dad's life is drastically changed with information. Perspective shifts that cause us a lot of stress, a lot of anxiety, a lot of unnecessary emotional pendulum swinging. This is what I love about God. Jesus is the personification of God himself. He reveals to us who and how God is. 180 times in the Gospels, he refers to God as a father. When Jesus teaches us to pray, he says to open our prayer with our Father. But see, if our perception of God is skewed, like the perception that Buddy had of reality, like the perception now that the father has of this freak who just showed up in his office, we will even potentially be derailed by what's going on in our lives. Why? Because we haven't settled the identity issue. Matthew 7, 9 through 11, Jesus addresses this when he's speaking in the Sermon on the Mount. He says this, "Do you know of any parent who would give his hungry child who asks for food a plate of rocks instead? Or when asked for a piece of fish, what parent would offer their child a snake instead? If you, imperfect as you are, know how to lovingly take care of your children and give them what's best, how much more ready is your Heavenly Father to give you wonderful gifts if you will ask Him?" What a powerful perspective shift. For me, when we were debating Christmas at the movies and we were talking about it, we were praying over it, I really felt, my wife and I just really felt like I was supposed to talk about Elf. I do love the movie, so it's fun to watch and fun to think about. But the real reason why we felt Elf was because we made Elf an acronym. Forever Loving Father. That's who God is. He's an ever-loving Father. But if I have a flawed perception of God, it will flaw my pursuit of God and in turn flaw my life. I love the whole story of Elf, though. If you've not watched the movie, you need to watch it. Because by the end of the movie, Buddy is reconciled to his father. His life is forever changed. He meets a woman and they have a baby. And he's living life. And he does something powerful. He writes a book about his story. He uses his story to help others. See, we started with Jingle Jangle and the redemptive nature of Jingle Jangle. We went to Home Alone and talked about the redemptive nature of God in Home Alone. And there is a redemptive nature of God in the movie Elf as well. Because the Bible goes on to say in 2 Corinthians 5:18, and God has made all things new and reconciled us to himself and given us the ministry of reconciling others to God. I like the way Dr. Bill Johnson says it. He says, Jesus came to an orphan planet to reconcile us and bring us back to God. But he starts at an orphanage and ends in a family. God tells us in the book of Psalms that he takes the orphan and he places them in families. I heard a story recently from a recent news article that came out several years ago. I said recent, but I mean it's most recent. About an orphanage in India that had over 200 girls. And those girls all had the same name. And their name in Hindi meant unwanted. Every girl. Now that gripped me because I have a daughter. And I love daddies with daughters. I don't know, there's just something. If God blessed you with daughters, then there's something special about you. There was a back in the day, if you didn't have a son, you know, you were upset. You know, all that kind of stuff. But honestly, I'm honored to have a daughter. But to think, and I heard the story, and I just, y'all know me, I'm emotional anyway, and I just cry. To understand that there's these 200 little girls who were all called unwanted. But thanks be to God, they were attached to an orphanage that was a gospel teaching and preaching orphanage. And they started preaching the gospel. They started talking to them. And for those of you that don't know, gospel means good news. It's not some religious pattern of do's and don'ts. It's the good news of Jesus. And they started talking to these young ladies about the good news of Jesus. And they started pointing pictures. They started painting pictures verbally with who God is. And they started discipling them. And they started ministering to them. And all of these ladies, these young girls, started to accept Jesus. They started to give their lives to Jesus. And not long after this process, they sat down with the ladies and they said, ladies, we want to have a name-changing ceremony. We want to change your name from unwanted to something else. And we want you to choose your name. And it blew my mind in hearing this that the girls wanted their names to mean love, to mean purpose, to mean destiny, to mean hope. Why? Because the gospel was able to move into an unwanted situation and produce transformation. To give identity where identity must be obtained, which is from the Father. You see, long before I'm a husband, long before I'm a father, long before I'm a pastor, a friend, a teacher, a musician, a singer, you name it, you add all of the things, long before I'm any of those things, I'm a son of God. I'm a son of God. All of those other things can very easily change. I don't want them to change. None of us want them to change. But they can change. Yesterday, I said, until we meet again, to Mama Nell Young, because she transitioned from this life to the next life. was a hard day for me. It's been a hard week for me, but a hard week for many of you. But life happens. We lose people that we love. Things happen. And if our identity is wrapped up in anything else, when those things happen, it will shake us to the core. It will cause us to have conversations where we tell people, you know, I'm doubting my faith. Doubting where I am right now and where I stand right now with God. Why? Because the identity issue has not been settled. Our identity has got to come from God. My last example is pulled from the life of David. David, and I don't have time to really unpack all of these details, but David is the king of Israel that is told by God that has a heart after himself, that God says he has a heart after me. And he makes the promise, and he even makes a covenant with David that the throne will never leave your bloodline. There will always be someone of your bloodline that will always sit on the throne of Israel. And God honored that, and so because of that covenant, Jesus came through and was a direct descendant of David, who's in his bloodline. But there was a portion of David's kingship where David's son Absalom began to have an uprising against him. And the Bible says that at a certain point when Absalom started to come against him, that David just left the kingdom. He walked out. And I always found it interesting that David goes right back to the place where he got his identity. He goes back to watching sheep on the backside of the desert. Because it didn't matter to David whether king was part of his title, whether son was part of his title, because when he was invited to be a part, when the invitation came to Jesse to invite all of his sons to come to the time with the prophet, he was left out. So he didn't even have the son title that he could cling to. The only thing he could cling to was his relationship with God. It was the steady, it was the constant, it was the North Star in his life. So when David encounters this uprising, he wasn't attached to his title. He was attached to his identity as a son of God. So he just walked out. Now, obviously, we know our biblical history. He came right back and became, you know, reinstated, and Absalom lost his life and all of those things. But my point in all of that is that David had his bearing of who he was because it came from time in God's presence. I want you to bow your heads and close your eyes today. It is my prayer that something today was done or said that caused an aha moment for you. An internal spiritual awareness. Maybe a question was able to rise on the inside of you and you started to question, wow, do I know who I am in God? Am I in a relationship with Jesus? Where is God in my life? If you're here within the sound of my voice today and any of those questions, any of those things happened or are happening on the inside of you, then I just want to talk to you for a few moments because I believe that's God speaking to you. But remember, my internal perspective of God will determine my pursuit of God. So the truth is, you might not even realize that all those questions and all those feelings are God-based and God-centered. That's his spirit now ministering to you, speaking to you. If that's you, all you have to do to cause there to be an answer to that question, to cause the God-sized hole that we all have in our lives that can only be filled by God. If we try to fill it with anything else, it creates a vacuum. It can only be filled by God. But if that's you and you want to fill that God-sized hole in you, the way you do that is through asking Jesus to come into your life, giving your life to him because he gave his life for you. No one's looking around. We're not going to call you out. But if that's you and you're like, you know what? I need someone to pray with me today. I need to get things right with Jesus. I just want you to raise your hand. Just slip your hand up real quick and put it right back down again. Yes. If you're watching online or in the building, I want every one of us to pray this prayer together. I want you to say, Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God, that you gave your life so I could have life. Forgive me of my sin. Come into my life. I make you the Lord of my life. In Jesus' name I pray. And everyone said amen. Now put your hands together. Thank God for salvation. If you're online or in the building and you prayed that prayer with me, take out your cell phone real quick. Take out your cell phone. Open up your text message area. Text NEW to this number. It's on the screens. I'm going to say it to you now. 888-817-0806. Just text the word NEW to 888-817-0806. It's going to send you a link. Hit that link. Watch the video. You don't have to do that right this second. And then just put your name, your email address, your phone number, whether you're online or in the building. And that will let us know that you prayed that prayer with us this morning so that we can partner with you in the faith walk. Because this is not something that we do alone. There's a video of me talking to you, and I'm telling you that right there. This is not something that you do alone. This is something that we do together in the community faith. But if you made that decision, you just made the greatest decision of your life. Put your hands together one more time. I thank God for the word. Pastor Jennifer.
Yes. Man, thank you guys so much for being here on Christmas Sunday here at Harvest. I want to thank our dance team. Didn't they do a great job? I'm so proud of those girls. In fact, dance team members, meet me up here. We need to get a picture together, so do not leave. But we had a competition going for today. Some of you may be aware. Some of you may not. One of the competitions was for our online people, our online congregation that watches and tunes in. And we asked them to like the video today and to even share it, and that we would do a drawing. And so Pastor Brian, our online campus pastor, he sent me the name of our winner this morning. So for Elaine Severin, you are the winner of a $25 gift card. And so, yes, put our hands together. So he'll be reaching out to you to get your address to make sure we get that sent to the right people. Now, our very next competition today, if you follow us online or you've been coming on Sundays, every Sunday we've been wearing crazy things. So like the first Sunday in December, we wore flannel. Last Sunday was ugly Christmas sweater. Today was just all out crazy Christmas because obviously we were watching the movie Buddy the Elf. And how many know Buddy the Elf absolutely loves Christmas, everything about it. And so today we ask everybody to just be crazy out there Christmas. And the competition today has been tough. But we have had some judges that have been around looking and seeing. And we've got our second place winners. So if Jose and Misty will come up for our second place crazy Christmas. Yes. Maybe we could get some pictures, Jada, for online. Yes. They just outdid, like, look at them. So super cute. Jose and Misty, congratulations on this. Smile for Jada real quick. And then for our first place winner is, drum roll, do we have drum roll? We have on our knees, is Jennifer West. Look at her. First place winner. She went all out. All out. Here you go. Thank you so much for participating. If you'll direct your attention to the screens, we have a few announcements. I promise I'm about to dismiss you. Watch our announcements for this week.
Hey family, thank you for joining us. If you're a first-time guest, we are honored to have you and would love to connect with you. Please fill out a Connect card and give it to one of our Connection hosts in the lobby as you exit. And don't forget to grab your free gift for first-time guests. You can also text the word WELCOME to 904-853-3373 to fill out our digital Connect card.
We will resume our Next Steps classes starting the new year, so if you are new to Harvest or just ready to get involved, I personally invite you to attend. You can text the word NEXT to 904-853-3373 to RSVP.
In honor of the holiday season, we will not be having our midweek services the 22nd or the 29th, but we want to invite you all, along with your family and friends, to our Christmas Eve service at 6 p.m. This is a laid-back and intimate service where we celebrate our Savior's birth, and we would love to have you with us. As you head out, don't forget to take a picture with Buddy the Elf, who's joined us all the way from the North Pole. Have a Merry Christmas and come back next week, same time, for our final showing of Christmas at the Movies.
Merry Christmas!
And once you get your tithe, get your offering ready. As you're exiting, there's going to be people back there, and you can place your tithe and offering. If you call Harvest your home, your tithe, obviously, yes, it belongs to your church. We teach. In fact, can I give you a quick testimony as you're getting your tithe and offering together? In November, we taught about God's economic system. And in God's economic system, He wants you blessed, church. That's what you need to understand. He wants you blessed abundantly, is what the Bible says, above all you could ask or think. And we've had tons of testimonies that have been rolling in since we taught on giving in the month of November. This one text that came into my husband a few weeks ago was phenomenal. And I want to celebrate with this person by sharing it with you. This person, they said that their business, their company, was bought out by another company. And the company said, we know that we owe you paid time off. We understand that you have vacation time saved up and you want that now in cash. We get that. We can't afford to give everybody that all at once. We're going to have to pay you as we can. But this person said that they began tithing, they began to believe God and trust God, and they got notice that they're going to get everything that they were owed in one lump sum of money. And I'm just telling you, that is God. He's so faithful. I'm telling you, but like my husband said, it's the one thing in the Bible that he says, test me in this. Prove me in this. Amen? So I want you to hold your tithe, hold your offering up high. Father God, we love you so much. We're so thankful for being, you are such a faithful Father to us that we don't have to be afraid. As we sang, the song goes, Emmanuel, God with us. We thank you for being God with us, never leaving us, never forsaking us. We put our hope in you, we put our trust in you, and we say we love you, and we say thank you, thank you, thank you. In Jesus' name, and everybody said with a loud voice, amen, amen. Listen, we love you. Merry Christmas, and we hope to see you at Christmas Eve. Don't forget, dancers, come up here for a quick picture. Yes.
Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. We ask ourselves, who am I to be brilliant, gorgeous, talented, fabulous? Actually, who are you not to be? You are a child of God. Your playing small does not serve the world. There is nothing enlightened about shrinking so that other people won't feel insecure around you. We are all meant to shine as children do. We were born to make manifest the glory of God that is within us. It's not just in some of us, it's in everyone. And as we let our own light shine, we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same. As we are liberated from our own fear, our presence automatically liberates others.
Christmas I gave my loving dad a most lovely lavender tie.
On the second day of Christmas I gave my loving dad two silken scarves.